Well, again, a warm welcome and a special greeting if you are watching online, worshiping with us for the first or second time, or you're here in person for the first or second time. I hope that we'll have an opportunity to greet one another and get to know one another. Every summer in July, we have a fun little series called God Goes to Broadway, in which we look at Broadway musicals and some of the theological questions that emerge from them. Today's musical talks about so many really important and timely things: injustice, social unrest, systemic poverty, food shortages, economic hardships, and the heartless attitude of many in the upper class towards those who are poor. This sounds to me like a soundtrack for the summer of 2022. These are the same issues that moved the French author Victor Hugo to write a novel called Les Misérables. It was published in 1862. Les Misérables, when translated from the French, means the wretched or the outcasts. Well, eventually the novel would be translated into many different languages and read around the world. But the critics panned the novel, but the common people loved it, perhaps because they knew what it was to be Les Mis. Now, Victor Hugo was a poet and an author, and he was deeply engaged in the political life of his era. His poems, his works of fiction, they reflect the themes that were happening in the society in which he lived. Now, the inspiration for Les Mis came from an encounter Victor Hugo had on the streets of Paris one day in 1845. One day he saw an impoverished man who was being arrested for stealing a loaf of bread. And while the arrest was taking place, this beautiful carriage pulled up alongside next to the man. And in the carriage was a beautifully adorned woman with jewels and ribbons, and the woman did not even see the man on the street being arrested. He saw her. She did not even become aware of him. This man on the street would become the character Valjean in the novel. There's another story behind the novel. It says that Hugo once saw a woman who was a prostitute out on the street being accosted by a man. And when she struck back at the man accosting her, the police tried to arrest her. And Victor Hugo intervened on her behalf. Now, that story will become the backdrop of the character Fantine. Les Mis was first translated into English, and the book was a whopping 1,500 pages, just a little light summer reading for you. It was a musical and first played in London. It opened here in the United States on Broadway in 1987, where it received 12 Tony Award nominations. And in 2012, it was made into a movie. So let's dig into the story a little bit, and let's start by talking about Jean Valjean, who was imprisoned, as Ariel said, for stealing a loaf of bread to feed his nephew, his sister's son, who was starving. He was sentenced to 5 years imprisonment for stealing a loaf of bread, and then, after he tried to escape, he was imprisoned for another 14 years. So for 19 years, he served on a prison chain gang where his name was never mentioned. He was referred to simply as prisoner 24601. Well, upon his release after 19 long years, he was required by law to carry with him some papers that identified him as being a convict now out on parole. Being poor had led to his crime. And the weight of that conviction was going to follow him around for the rest of his life. Mass incarceration of the poor in the 19th century in France left many wounded. And mass incarceration is a problem in our culture, too. Listen to this brief video by Brian Stevenson of the Equal Justice Initiative.
Mass incarceration has had a devastating impact on all Americans. But it's been particularly devastating to the poor and people of color. Black men are 6 times more likely to go to prison for committing the same offenses that white people commit. So to confront that, we've got to do something about these basic inequalities in American society. Inequality is racism. Inequality is exploitation of the poor. Inequality is abuse of power. Late one night, when I was a young lawyer in Atlanta, Georgia, I got in my car and I drove home. Had an old beat-up car, and the car didn't always have the radio operating, but this night the radio was operating. And I was just enjoying it so much that when I got to my apartment, I stayed in the car to listen to these songs. And after 10 or 15 minutes, an Atlanta SWAT car showed up. I got out to see what he wanted. And in that instant, this officer drew his weapon and he said, "Move and I'll blow your head off." I was 28, been practicing law for about a year. And I knew to say to that police officer, "It's all right, it's okay." But if the same thing had happened to me when I was 16, I probably would have run. And it burdens me that we have kids in this country that have to know how to navigate those situations, who have to deal with the presumption of dangerousness and guilt in ways where their lives are at risk. When you tolerate racial inequality for generations, these inequalities become part of the culture and the political system. We need a generation of people in this country who are dedicated to fighting inequality. Justice doesn't come when you only choose to do what's comfortable and convenient. It sometimes requires you to do uncomfortable and inconvenient things.
Isn't it interesting how our society today so reflects what was happening at the time Les Miserables was written? Well, like many formerly incarcerated persons, finding work was really difficult for Jean Valjean. He was rejected by one employer after another because he had been a convict, and he finally lands at the feet of a priest who gives him food and shelter for the night. During the night, a desperate Valjean gets up, steals some silver, and was caught by the priest. Valjean hits the priest and heads out into the night with his stolen treasure. The next morning, something amazing will happen, upon which the story and Jean Valjean's life will pivot. Police officers saw him on the street. They demand to see his papers, and while he's getting out his papers, they find the stolen silver that belongs to the priest. Listen to what happens next.
Put him down! Stay there!
Monseigneur, we have your silver. We caught this man red-handed.
You had the nerve to say you gave him this.
That is right. But my friend, you left so early. Surely something slipped your mind. You forgot. I gave these also. Would you leave the best behind? Monsieur, release him. This man has spoken true. I commend you for your duty. Now God's blessing go with you. But remember this, my brother. See in this some higher plan. You must use this precious silver to become an honest man. By the witness of the martyrs, by the passion and the blood, God has raised you out of darkness. I have saved your soul for
God has raised you out of darkness. I have saved your soul for God. On this encounter, everything will pivot. Humbled by the priest's grace, Valjean resolves to lead a redeemed life. So, how does a person live a life after an encounter with grace like that? Luke's gospel tells us that the table was set for a proper meal. It's really quite a coup that Simon was able to secure this new rabbi as a dinner guest in his home, and the whole town was buzzing with talk of Jesus. The dinner was served at a table that was low to the ground where the diners reclined, and the table was probably in the courtyard of the house, which would have allowed all of the neighbors and the townspeople to come and to hear and to see Jesus. See, people were curious about him. But unlike the woman in the fancy carriage that Victor Hugo observed, Jesus was different. He saw people. He noticed people, all the people, especially those who were hurting. Now, a special guest like a visiting rabbi should have been treated with great hospitality. After his feet had been washed, he should have been offered oil to rub into his dry hands and feet to soften them in that dry and arid climate. Yet no water, no oil, no hospitality was offered to Jesus. Luke says, Jesus took his place at the table, and into the courtyard bursts a woman. She was that woman. You know the one with the reputation, the one with whom you refused to make eye contact. Luke does not tell us what she had done, only that she was a sinner. But clearly the woman had had some prior encounter with Jesus. Clearly she had been the recipient of him seeing her, valuing her, loving her. She says not a word. She goes straight to Jesus, and she stands by him, weeping with love. She bathes his feet with her tears. She wiped his feet with her hair and anointed them with fragrant oil. In Les Mis, she may have been the character Fantine. She was a single mother, forced to work in a factory to support her daughter, Cosette. Fantine rejected the advances of a man in the factory who took revenge on her and all of the employees. She gets fired from her job, and she is so desperate for money that she sells first her locket and then her hair and even some of her teeth before she's finally forced into a life of prostitution, all to raise money to care for her child because she is so poor. One day on the street, she was fighting back with an abusive man, and the police are trying to arrest her. And just like what Victor Hugo saw, Jean Valjean happened by at that time on the scene and realized that Fantine had once worked for him in his factory. So what will a man do who has been the recipient himself of amazing grace? He orders Javert to release her. He takes her to the hospital. He pays for her medical care, and he promises before she dies that he will find and raise her daughter, Cosette. It sounds like the Good Samaritan, does it not? The grace that Valjean received in his life begins to snowball and have effects on others. He had worked hard and become a successful businessman running this factory. One day, a man outside of his factory was pinned beneath a wagon, and Valjean, who had spent 19 years working on that chain gang and had developed incredibly strong muscles, lifts up the wagon, and the man is released. Grace continues to snowball. But friends, wherever there is grace, there will be pushback. This is Javert. He was the prison guard who supervised that chain gang. It was there he first met prisoner 24601, Jean Valjean. Javert takes his role as the keeper of the law very seriously. He is there to make sure that those who have been convicted of a crime will do the time, and they will be punished to the fullest extent of the law, and he will follow up with them even after their parole. Javert insists that for a criminal like Valjean, that they can never change for the better. Javert reminds me of the New Testament man who was known as Saul. Saul was a persecutor of the followers of Jesus. He would take them as prisoners and haul them, men, women, and children, off to Jerusalem. Acts chapter 9 tells us that one day he was walking on a road to Damascus when suddenly Saul was struck by a blinding light and a voice cried out, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me?" And he did not know, nor did the men with him know, that that was the voice of Jesus. Acts 9:8 says this, "Saul got up from the ground, and though his eyes were open, he could see nothing." Though his eyes were open, he could see nothing. How often is that true for us? How often are we like the woman in the carriage who did not see the man experiencing poverty? Our eyes are open, but we do not see our neighbor who is hurting, the struggles of the poor, the injustice in our world. And sometimes, even though our eyes are open, we fail to see God at work in our lives, in the world. We fail to see the goodness in others. We fail to see the possibility that others can grow and change. Though our eyes are open, we're like Javert and we miss the opportunity to seize grace. So it was with Javert. He refused to see that grace could indeed change a person, that grace indeed had changed a person. In the play, there's a scene in which a man who has been identified as Valjean has been arrested and brought to the court, but it's a case of mistaken identity. Valjean realizes that this man who's been falsely accused as being him could free him forever if he would only flee, but he was unwilling for that other man to take his place. Valjean goes to court and identifies himself, and Javert is unimpressed with his honesty and integrity. He still does not see. Later on, we will find Javert in alliance with the French army. Undercover, he goes to talk with Marius and the other revolutionaries, and he says, "The government will not attack you that night." And in the crowd is a little boy who recognizes him and exposes him as the spy he is. Listen as Stellan Harrison sings Little People from Les Mis.
They laugh at me, these fellows, just because I am small. They laugh at me because I'm not 100 feet tall. I tell them there's a lot to learn down here on the ground. The world is big, but little people turn it around. Goliath was a bruiser who was tall as the sky. But David threw a right and gave him one in the eye. I never read the Bible, but I know that it's true. It only goes to show what little people can do. A worm can roll a stone, a bee can sting a bear. A fly can fly around Versailles, cause flies don't care. A sparrow in a hat can make a happy home. A flea can bite the bottom of a pope in Rome. So listen here, professor, with your head in a cloud. It's often kind of useful to get lost in a crowd. So keep your universities, I don't give a damn. For better or for worse is the way that I am. Be careful as you grow, cause little people grow. And little people know, when little people fight. We may look easy pickings, but we got some bite. So never kick a dog, because he's just a pup. You better run for cover when the pup grows up. And we'll fight like 20 armies and we won't give up. A worm can roll a stone, a bee can sting a bear. A fly can fly around Versailles cause flies don't care. A sparrow in a hat can make a happy home. A flea can bite the bottom of a pope in Rome.
Nice job, Stellan. Thank you. Valjean asks to take charge of the spy Javert. And as soon as they are alone, Valjean does something amazing. He frees him. Javert warns him that he will never give up the pursuit of bringing him back into prison, but Valjean says there are no conditions to Javert being released. Valjean holds no grudges against Javert for only doing his duty. Even in the face of this incredible grace offered to himself, Javert remains strident on continuing to punish Valjean and other prisoners. His eyes remain closed. In the midst of this battle, this French Revolution, Valjean hears a young man named Marius talking about his love for Cosette, who is Valjean's adopted daughter. Valjean declares that this young man is the son whom he has never had, and he begins to pray for Marius' safety in this beautiful song called Bring Him Home, which will be sung by our friend David Berger.
God on high, hear my prayer in my need. Him rest, heaven blessed, bring him home, bring him home, bring him home. He's like the sun I might have known. If God had granted me a son, the summers die one by one. How soon they fly on. And I am old and will be gone. Bring him peace. Joy. He is young, he is only a boy. You can take, you can give, let him be. Let him live. If I die, let me die. Let him live. Bring him home. Bring him home.
Young Marius is injured in battle. Valjean finds him near death, and he puts him over his shoulder and carries him through the wretchedly dirty sewers of the city to a place of safety. As he emerges from the sewer, there is Javert. Valjean begs him, just give me 1 hour that I might take Marius to the doctor, and reluctantly Javert agrees. But then he is torn, Javert, between his beliefs about God and his beliefs about upholding the law. And he will die, Javert, without ever opening his eyes. But it does not have to be that way. We do not have to remain closed off to grace, from grace. Saul, the persecutor of the followers of Jesus, had, as it says in the book of Acts, the scales fall from his eyes. And he comes to see God, comes to know God, comes to experience grace and mercy and forgiveness for himself, and he sees that it can change people's lives. His name is changed to Paul, and he will go on to play a huge role in spreading the gospel. Back to Les Mis. Marius and Cosette eventually marry. And Marius discovers that it was Valjean who saved him after his battle injury. He learns that Valjean is hiding in a monastery. He's fled there to keep Cosette safe from Javert, and he does not know that Javert has died. So now they go to the monastery, these newlyweds, and Valjean is near death. Marius and Cosette arrive just moments before he dies. And at last, Jean Valjean, the recipient of God's grace, the giver of God's grace, is at last at peace. Here are some of the words in the final song. Listen closely to the biblical imagery, the imagery of heaven and the kingdom of God. Valjean begins, "Forgive me all my trespasses and take me to your glory. Take my hand, I'll lead you to salvation. Take my love, your love is everlasting. And remember the truth that once was spoken. To love another person is to see the face of God."
Lord in heaven, look down on him in mercy.
Forgive me all my trespasses and take me to your glory.
Take my hand, I'll lead you to salvation. Take my love, for love is everlasting.
And remember the truth that once was spoken. Love another person is to see the face of
when we pray together the Lord's Prayer, there is a line where we say, "Let your kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven." And that is the picture that's being presented for us, being painted for us. Therein lies the truth of the gospel. So may you experience grace as Valjean did. May you give grace freely as the priest did. May you take up the plowshare and put away your sword. May it be so. Amen.